This video is to answer some questions for the Royal Geographic Society. This is part of their 21st Century Challenges series. So first, the general questions. So the first question right up here is, will changes in education in the coming decades be evolutionary or revolutionary? Evolutionary. So evolutionary would kind of imply small changes, maybe not so noticeable changes, but then maybe over a long period of time, they add up to a lot. Or revolutionary, everything all at once. And you know, maybe I hope you don't think that I'm not answering the question, but I think it's going to be both. You know, it's already been stated, independent of education, that we are in an information revolution right now. And I think that's pretty obvious. First, you have the computers, and then obviously you have the internet, and everything now becomes accessible, and it's becoming all that more accessible every almost moment that passes by. The funny thing is it's the information revolution, and there's no industry that revolves around information more than education. I guess there's other industries that are close, like finance and whatever else. But education really is about, I would say, information or knowledge or conveying information or transferring understanding from one person to another. So it really is about transferring information or communication between different people. And so the information revolution should, I guess, naturally, the education revolution should be part of it. And it really just maybe hasn't for a bunch of reasons. There's different inertias in place to keep it from changing. My sense is, and this is true of many things, is that when people are most pessimistic about something, that's when it's about to change in a really, really, really big way. That's when it's about to give. And I think we are at that moment in education where, sure, people have been talking about technology education for a long time. People have been trying to improve education for a long time. But the unfortunate narrative is every year we just hear things they seem, or at least based on the narrative we're hearing in the media, it seems like it's getting worse, getting more expensive too. And so depending on how you do it, you know, either worse performance at kind of the grade school levels or at the higher education level, it's just getting more and more and more expensive and less affordable. And even if you can afford it and you can take on the loans, it's becoming less clear that you're able to even get the return when you go into the job market, whether you're even necessarily that employable. So yes, I think the revolution is coming. I think it's going to come in a bunch of different ways. I think you're going to start seeing a decoupling of learning from credentialing. So right now, the word education is even kind of muddled because it's actually a whole bunch of things. Inside of education, you have the idea of learning, and this is what most people associate with education. But you also have the idea of credentialing, which is, you know, I got a degree from here or there. And then you also have an element of socialization, which is a very important element, socialization. And when people talk about education, it's not clear what they're talking about. Most people are talking about, think they're talking about this, but when you ask them why they're willing to go $200,000 in debt, they'll be talking about this right here. So what I hope to see is that this actually becomes decoupled. And when it becomes decoupled, it becomes actually more interesting. Because if someone can earn a credential by proving what they know, and they don't have to sit someplace for 4 years, and they don't have to pay $200,000, then all of a sudden the learning will happen in whatever way is easiest for that person. So it could be through something like the Khan Academy. It could be attending a traditional university. It could be learning on the job. And what's powerful that is, if the credential is done independently from that, then the credential can also become much more powerful. Right now you have a reality where you have thousands of universities, and I'll talk about university. The high school diploma has become almost, you know, meaningless now. No one even says, "Oh, I'll give you a job because you have a high school diploma." They don't know what that even means. And on the other side of it, you have people getting into universities that don't have a high school diploma, that just have really good standardized test scores, and they've done amazing things when they were before college and they were homeschooled or whatever. So what you have right now is the credentialing is kind of being done by the same people who are doing the learning, and so it makes everyone say, well, look, how do we know what the standards are at that university? How do we know what the standards are at that high school? And so that's why it's making standardized tests and all of that so valuable, regardless of whether you actually view them as valuable, but that's why people are putting so much emphasis on them. And so what would be valuable is if the credential is just more recognized, if there's a nationally or internationally recognized credentials. Because right now you could go to a regional university, and maybe your regional university or your local community college, maybe it's amazing at this. Maybe it's better than Harvard at this. Maybe it's better than any university at the teaching part. And maybe its graduates actually do know the material really, you know, deeply and amazing, and they know it better than the kids graduating from the Ivy League. But the sad reality right now is even if they do, their credential will not carry as much weight in the eyes of most employers as that Harvard degree will, or that Stanford degree, or that MIT degree. And so they have a credentialing problem. But if you decouple these things, these students who learn from the regional university could go and prove that they know it just as good as anyone else. And so you know, I think you're gonna see some very interesting things here. I think once you open this up and people can get the credential, and hopefully that obviously the cost of getting tested, even if it's a very rigorous test, even if it's a more rigorous test than what's going on right now in the best universities, that's not going to cost $50,000 a year. You know, you ask a university right now why they're charging $50,000 a year, they'll say it's, oh, look at our facilities, look at our campus, look at our professor salaries. They're not going to say, they don't say we're charging you $50,000 a year because we're giving you really rigorous exams. We're giving you oral exams and all the rest. And so if you ask students why they're paying $50,000, they'll tell you that for the most part they're paying for the credentials, and then some students hopefully for the learning, and then some for the socialization. And that socialization can take many forms. But I suspect the credentialing itself can be done in a better way than it's being done now, and that can be much cheaper. You know, I'm talking in the orders of hundreds of dollars as opposed to thousands of dollars. And then it opens up the learning part to whatever works best. And I suspect once you do that, then now higher education institutions won't have this kind of kind of control over the market, and it'll be very hard for them to justify raising their tuition 6% every year. And it'd be very hard for them to, they would have to prove the case that it really is worth $50,000, that their graduates really are performing better on these credentials than, say, people who use the Khan Academy or go to their local community college or learn on the job. So I think you're definitely going to see that coming, and I think in 10 years or so you're going to see that shift, and you're actually going to see that tuition costs are going to give because they really can't. They're already becoming so unaffordable for so many people that I think everyone's going to wake up at some point and realize that you know, there has to be another way. How important is knowledge in a modern education? So knowledge is one of these words. It depends how you think about knowledge. Is knowledge, you know, fact information? Is it a specific skill set? Is it a meta level skill of kind of knowing how to learn? And you know, some would say it's all of the above. What I would say is what I think are the most important things in a modern education. I think it's the ability to be creative. I think it's the ability to kind of, you know, go into an open space that where nothing is defined, and be able to look at and look at the tools that are available to you and put something together that meets a problem. And that this could be in a technical sense, or it could be in a business sense, or a market, whatever sense. And so I think the most important things that people should get from their education is the ability to make things, the ability to create things. And unfortunately, that's the thing that I think is completely absent from our current education. I mean, one example is math, and there's a huge debate about what the best way to teach math is and all the rest. But what's shocking is that no one ever says, well, maybe there should be engineering in education. To some degree, that's limited by people's perception of whether we can get you know, proper engineering even taught, you know, whether we can find the talent to teach the engineering in schools. But no one ever says, because frankly, the ability to engineer, and I'm saying engineering in the broadest sense of the word, not what people normally associate with engineering. I'm saying engineering, which is really, and most people don't normally associate it as a deeply creative field, but it is a deeply creative. In fact, engineering is, by its very nature, it's creating things that never existed before. And so engineering is not something that's emphasized right now. I would, you know, there might be a music class, and music class is focused on playing things, but you see very little composition, especially at the K-12 level. Everything is focused on playing things that someone else has written. So the creativity is de-emphasized in school right now, and I think that's the very thing that has to be emphasized a lot more heavily, that just ability, because frankly, and this is the reality of the modern world, is that the tools are going to change, the jobs are going to change, the information you need to know for that job are going to change, but what you really need to do is that ability to, one, create something out of nothing, so that's the creativity, and I would say that the second thing is this ability to kind of self-teach yourself. So look at the resources that are in the world to give yourself the tools you need to be able to create that thing. The next question. If the era of a job for life is over and we all need to be more adaptable, Do you foresee a future of people self-educating through their lives? So I guess I was, my peripheral vision was reading this question. So yes, I think self-educating throughout life, beyond just the economic aspects of it maybe being a requirement now because the world is changing so fast and jobs are changing so fast. But I also just think it's healthy from a happiness point of view. Just as people go to the gym, and they do exercise, and not because they're going to compete in some sport, not because they're paid to compete in exercise. They do it because it's good for their health, and they do it because they know it makes them happy. And there's even been studies that endorphins get released in your brain and all of that. And I think the exact same thing is true of learning. I mean, you're just exercising a different part of what it means to be a human. You're exercising your brain. And so one, I think it's going to be an economic imperative. You will need to self-educate through your life. I mean, going back to this answer, the context is going to keep changing. The only skill that will really be valuable is the ability to learn very quickly and then apply it in a creative way to create something that has never existed before. And I also think hopefully people will start to recognize that self-education is an economic imperative, but it's also a really satisfying thing that will give people more happiness than many of the things that people perceive that will give them happiness, like more square footage or a fancier car. Now, Khan Academy related. What are your aspirations for the growth of the Khan Academy? So our attitude towards growth is, I mean, we'd obviously love as many students as possible to use it, but our attitude is let's focus on what we are producing. And let's make sure it's as compelling of an experience for the people who are using it as right now as possible. And if we do that, other people will find it compelling as well. And those people who are using it and finding it valuable right now will tell other people. And so in terms of user growth, I mean, I could hope that it continues to grow at the rate it's doing. It grew tenfold in this past year, and we're at about 2 million unique students a month. But we don't want to get to 20 million or 200 million and have a bad experience. Our main focus is keep tight on the experience. If you talk about growth from a future point of view, we hope to expand the faculty, and this is something I've started hinting at a little bit, but I don't want to be the only person teaching. I do want to teach on Khan Academy the rest of my life, but I think there's other people who bring super valuable voices to the table. And so we're going to expand the faculty, and you'll hear more about this in the coming months. We're also going to expand kind of the platform that we have. We hope to enable students to communicate with each other and to turn really into a community experience. And we just have to think of a good way to do that. And obviously, expanding the faculty, but this also goes with the software part of it. We want to expand the content base, both the video side, but also the exercises. So eventually you can also use Khan Academy as a way to learn learn art history or to learn chemistry or whatever, to actually practice those things. Your thoughts on flipping the classroom? I thought this was fantastic. Well, thank you for thinking it was fantastic. But one thing I want to emphasize, because I talk about flipping the classroom in that TED Talk and got a lot of press, and the notion is that these high school teachers were saying, hey, Sal gave the lecture, so let's let my students watch Sal's videos, and then the teacher can use class time for interaction. And that I 110% agree with that idea. What we're advocating now is taking that even further. So it's not even a pure flip. It's now every student, whether they're at home or at the classroom, working at their own pace, at their own time. And then the teacher intervenes either when there is a need to do an interactive project or a conversation, or the teacher intervenes when they see a student being stuck. So you can go to a pure flip, but then when you go to what we're talking about, it becomes a little less pure of a flip. We're saying, look, if a kid needs to watch a video in the classroom, that's okay. We don't think that the classroom should be about watching videos, but if that's what they need at that moment for that kid, not all the kids, that kid, they can watch the video. And if they want to do exercises at home, that's great. But the important thing is that they can fully leverage the humans in the classroom, their peers and the teacher, and that the teacher is spending every moment of his or her time in meaningful interactions with students and really taking them to the next level. And then the last question is, your thoughts on the potential of game mechanics and ICT in general to encourage the learning process. Any clear evidence in the Khan Academy? So there is this layer of points and badges and streaks and things like that in the Khan Academy. Anecdotally, it seems like a lot of kids find it compelling. We've Even in the data in the school, it looks like a lot of kids became more engaged when we threw this layer on. But we're constantly experimenting with it, and we're constantly making sure that it's driving the right behaviors. That it's not that kids aren't just looking at the badges or the points; that they really are getting good gains, and they're starting to enjoy the learning process itself. And so the evidence, we saw really good results from Los Altos. I actually put some of those results in a previous video that I made today. So you can look at that, and that's why Los Altos is going district-wide. Not clear if that's due to the game mechanics or due to the content or some combination of both of them. But we hope to continue to explore this, and we're talking to the teachers and students constantly about how to tweak this so we can make it a better experience. And we also hope to put some, a lot of our game mechanics right now are for the most part extrinsic, so they're independent of the subject at hand. We also want to put a lot of intrinsic motivators. So some of the exercises themselves are like games, but they're games that are where deep subject matter help you solve the game. So this is something that we're just going to constantly try to iterate on and address. And this brings it to an important issue is, we've gotten a lot of press, and we hopefully think that we are having an impact right now, but we think we're very early on in the process, and we don't think that we have all the solutions. And I think what is kind of the opportunity that we have at the Khan Academy, what excites me is that we do have the traction that we can now become the best lab for really figuring out what works, and then getting traction on that. So we view ourselves, we're early in the game, in the baseball analogy, top of the first inning right now. Maybe I should make a cricket analogy, but I don't understand cricket. We think we're really early on, and so we think it's a very open-ended question on where we're going to take this. We really just want to be open-minded about building stuff, looking at the data, looking at the feedback, and then taking that seriously, and then continuing to refine it.